Hello, everyone. My name is Emma Paulino, and I am glad to be here with you today on an event on delivering asthma right care for hospital pharmacists. We already organized 2 weeks ago one session specifically designed for community pharmacists, but today we are focusing on how hospital pharmacists can assist in ensuring asthma right care is provided to patients around the world. We will also obviously be talking about interactions with community pharmacists and other healthcare professionals, but we will be focusing on the hospital setting. So for just to start, a few announcements for your information. So this webinar is being recorded and live streamed via YouTube and the FIP events website. The recording afterwards will be available on our website, www.fip.org. You may ask questions using the question box that is provided. So you can use the chat the chat log to introduce yourself. But if you would like to ask questions to any of the panelists that we have today, please use the question box. You are welcome to provide web feedback on this webinar to webinars@fip.org and also obviously to become a member of FIP on our website. So for today's program and focusing on asthma, you know that asthma affects up to 1 in 10 people globally. Living well with asthma depends on avoiding triggers and using good, safe medicines in the right way at the right time. However, there is currently much suboptimal use of medicines that can result in waste and harm, including avoidable hospital attendances and admissions. And we will be talking about that today. Hospital pharmacists can be an important part of the asthma pathway and powerful change agents. So this webinar will provide updates on major changes in international guidelines. And this will be a very short presentation, of course, but we will leave information about resources. These guidelines highlight asthma as an inflammatory condition, and for safety, no one over 12 should be treated with short-acting beta-agonist alone without inhaled corticosteroids. So we will talk about these updates in a while. So you will hear from experts from the Asthma Right Care social movement about how to make impactful change happen in the provision of asthma care within secondary care settings. So for today's program, as you can see, this is quite challenging to keep within this time frame that we have, which is 1.5 hours, to talk about all these issues. But we will be making a short introduction to Asthma Right Care and a short update of GINA guidelines 2021. We will talk about the use of emergency departments as standard asthma care and specifically over reliance on acute care. We will be making an introduction to Asthma Right Care emergency room posters. We will have a description of some practical examples of Asthma Right Care. In terms of hospital leadership, how to improve treatment for people with asthma in hospitals. And we will, as I've mentioned before, have a discussion about hospital pharmacist, community pharmacist relationships. Then we will finish with a short call to action. How can you get engaged and involved? And we will finalize with a discussion, hopefully with some time for Q&A. So please make sure that you use the question box provided for those questions. By the end of this webinar, we hope participants will have received a critical update on international asthma guidelines and the implications for hospital pharmacists, learned about tools available to start a conversation with patients and prescribers about asthma right care, including how to address over-reliance on SABA and acute care and how to use the right medicines in the right way, and also discussed what leadership opportunities, motivation, and capabilities are needed to bring about change, such as improved discharge from emergency departments and respiratory wards, and shared approaches between hospital and community pharmacists. So for this presentation, we will have three speakers, myself, Emma Paulino. I haven't introduced myself properly yet, so just briefly mention that I'm a community pharmacist from Portugal. In FIP, I'm a member of the Bureau, so I'm professional secretary of FIP, and I'm also part of the board of the IPCRG, which is the International Primary Care Respiratory Group. We will also have two very distinguished speakers that will follow. So we have Marina Garcia Pardo. She is a family physician working in the emergency room at the primary care setting in Mallorca, Spain. She is a member of GRAP, which is the Spanish Primary Care Respiratory Group, which is federated to IPCRG, where she develops education and research activity. She's also a researcher at the Chronic Respiratory Diseases in Primary Care Group at the IDISBA, the Research Institute of the Balearic Islands. She's currently collaborating with the Mallorcan Family Physicians Training Program to develop workshops and learning activities for young GP in asthma, COPD, spirometry, and inhalers. So welcome, Marina. It's very nice to have you here. I will also introduce the following speaker so that we can make a seamless transition between the presentations. So we have Dr. Toby Kapstick. He's a consultant pharmacist in respiratory pharmacist at the Leeds Teaching Hospitals NHS Trust. He's a chair of the UK Clinical Pharmacy Association Respiratory Group and is a member of the UK Inhaler Group and the British Thoracic Society Multi-Drug Resistant Tuberculosis Clinical Advice Service. Toby is an independent non-medical prescriber and runs clinics in the Leeds Interstitial Lung Disease and Tuberculosis Clinics. He works one day a week for NHS Leeds Clinical Commissioning Group to improve respiratory medicine's optimization, on his experience about this topic. But I will start with a short introduction to Asthma Right Care. So in the following minutes, and we can move to the next slide. Just to give you a sense of the urgency of addressing this issue, we know that asthma exacerbations and SABA use continue to impact patients worldwide. So we know that there are more than 339 million patients in the world with asthma, and we have quite a few million asthma exacerbations occurring still per year. And we still have SABA usage increasing across the globe despite the changes in the guidelines that I will be talking about shortly. So in the next slide, we can see results from an important study that was done. And we have here results showing that patients with asthma of all ages and severities are at risk of exacerbations. And here we have graphics that show time to first asthma exacerbations during follow-up by age groups and severities. This was a population-based cohort study from April 2007 to September 2015, which involved more than 424,000 patients with asthma. And as we can see, we have in all age groups, people at severe risk of exacerbations, which really points to the urgency of implementing not only new guidelines for the treatment, but also for correct follow-up and multidisciplinary approach to this issue. In the next slide, we see further results from this study, and we see also results from real-world studies that have shown that patients are at risk of exacerbations regardless of controller medication adherence or control, which is quite interesting as well. So we see that adherence to, for instance, to ICS therapy was not associated with the decrease on exacerbations for moderate to severe asthma patients. and even 25% of patients in a gene-defined control group had over one OCS use, emergency care use for acute exacerbations over 12 months. So we can see that we still have a lot to do in terms of really achieving better control for asthma patients around the world. So we also have some additional information the Sabina study, and it shows an overview of short-acting agonist use in asthma in European countries. And again, we can see that we have a change in the guidelines, we still have a high SABA use. And this is highlighted by the fact also that SABA is available even without a prescription in different countries. And we can see that in the different countries, we have an overuse of SABA canisters, which are dispensed to the patients in these different countries, even in countries where SABA is not non-prescription. So we still have a high prescribing level of SABA use in individuals. And again, we have here more detail. I won't go into much detail, but again, high SABA use observed in over 1/3 of UK asthma patients, which again highlights the need to not only educate healthcare professionals on new guidelines for the management of asthma, but also interact directly with patients to highlight how SABA use or increased SABA use may not be the best solution to control their asthma. And again, some more detail on the proportion of people receiving SABA in the last 12 months, again, highlighting a high use of SABA in different countries. We can possibly move. Okay, and what is needed in terms of improvement? We need change for improvement. And this is related to the fact that we have already seen that SABA use needs major improvement. We know already that first SABA conversations will affect future use. So it is very important that we use every opportunity to start a conversation about SABA use and how we can really change the panorama of prescription, but also use of relievers. We need healthcare professionals that want change. So this is what we are doing here, is engaging you in this conversation. In the next slide, we talk about what is right care, and right care is doing the right things and only the right things in the right way for the right people at the right time in the right place, whatever that means in the local context. So this has a lot of rights in it. So we have to make sure that we are aware of the situational analysis and that we are all working as a multidisciplinary team to ensure that we are aligned in terms of the terminology and also in terms of the engagement that we have with the patient himself. So in the next slide, and maybe we can already move to click on the various animations, but basically Asthma Right Care is a social movement, as I've mentioned. Originally, it involved 4 countries, but now it has expanded to many more territories. And of course, we are looking for more people to get engaged. So if you are interested, please contact us. We know that we have to involve various parts of the healthcare system because we need patients to get involved, we need politicians to be aware of the urgency of this issue. So this is a multi-stakeholder approach and we work at all levels to increase awareness and also to engage as many key people as possible, including patients themselves. And we obviously want to provoke a behavior shift from unconscious incompetence and using the right tools, and we will be talking about some of those tools here today, that we move to a situation where of mastery, where we have a conscious competence of unconscious incompetence. So I will give you now a very short update of GINA 2021 guidelines in terms of SABA use. I will be very quick on the slides, but you can have access to the whole guideline through the GINA organization website. So the Global Initiative for Asthma is an international nonprofit organization. And it aims to increase awareness of asthma among health professionals, health authorities, and the general public. And they publish guidelines which they frequently update according to best practices. So if you are interested, in the next slide, we can see that GINA issues reports, and it is updated, as I've mentioned, every year, and recommendations are then released as part of an integrated asthma strategy for symptom control and risk reduction. So which are the most recent changes? So actually, in 2019, we observed a fundamental change in asthma management, and this is according to the studies that I've already shown in terms of how people that use SABA as a reliever still experience acute exacerbations. So in the next slide, what we can see is that we observed these landmark changes in terms of the guidelines for asthma management, in that GINA no longer recommends SABA only treatment for asthma in adults or adolescents. And actually observed that higher use of SABA is in fact associated with adverse clinical outcomes. So not only it is beneficial for the control of the disease, but also it can be associated with adverse clinical outcomes, specifically for those patients that use more than 3 canisters per year. In 2020, we already see that we have new recommendations for preferred relievers, and the preferred reliever are low-dose ICS formoterol combination. And then in 2021, in the next slide, we can see also these changes applying to the controller and preferred reliever for both for adults and adolescents. Again, reliever recommendations as needed, low dose ICS formoterol. We don't see SABA as the preferred first line reliever. So the main update on the 2021 report, we can see updates in terms of track one, which is the preferred approach for asthma, and both for controllers and preferred relievers. And again, as a reliever, as needed, low dose ICS formoterol instead of short acting beta agonists, which only appears when the alternative, when the preferred option is not available or not an option anymore. So in the next slide, we actually can see a summary of this information. So the GINA 2021 treatment figure for adults and adolescents promotes as track one, low dose ICS formoterol as the reliever, and this is the preferred approach. And track two, with SABA as the reliever, only as an alternative approach, only if track one is not possible or is not preferred by a patient with no exacerbations on their current controller therapy. And most importantly, before considering a regimen with a SABA reliever, healthcare professionals should consider whether the patient is likely to be adherent with a daily controller, and if not, they will be exposed to the risks of the SABA only treatment. So this is to be taken into account when the healthcare professional is dealing with the patient and also communicating with the patient himself. So, and now, after this short update on Gina, and hopefully increasing your interest in terms of changing how we deal with asthma, I give the floor to Marina, who will talk to us about education in the emergency department. So welcome, Marina, the floor is yours.
Thank you very much, Emma. My name is Marina Garcia. I work in Mallorca. I am a family physician. I want to thank very much the FIP for inviting me to this webinar and to IPCRD also to give me this opportunity to show you how we work, how can we work in the emergency room, and how we are also trying to change our minds. With the education, we are family physicians, so education is in our DNA. We have to educate our patients and ourselves, so that's why I am here. So I will try to explain you my experience in the emergency room, where we are really connected with the pharmacy, with the local community pharmacist, because we work together, and at night we work very together. They are also on duty, and we have this problem, this concern about the over-reliance in SABA. Show you in a few slides, what do we know about these patients? Emma has shown us about the Sabina study, which is the newest one, but it's a few years that we know that the asthmatic patients are using a lot of salbutamol or SABA. Since the Realize study, developed in 8 European countries in 2014, where we knew that almost 40% of asthma patients are using a lot of SABA, up to the GINA control that is more than twice a week. Next slide, please, Anikan. From this study, we know that this patient, only 20% of these patients are really well controlled. All the other patients are partially or not controlled at all. But the most interesting things from this study will be seen in the next slide, please, is that our patients don't recognize the severity of their disease. The first thing is that they don't feel like having a condition or a disease. They don't feel ill people, because normally this range of patients are active people, young people working, having a lot of issues in their daily lives, and they don't have time to care about, and they just cope with this SABA reliever therapy. And when we ask them in this study how they feel, how they are subjectively, do you see in the third two columns that are the patients not controlled upon GINA definition? When we ask them, how do you feel? How is your asthma? 84% of these patients said, I am all right. It is okay. I feel well. So this is the big concern in my point of view, that the patients don't recognize the severity of their disease. And that is why they don't look for help. In the next slide, we will see that they need help. Asthma, they don't feel that asthma kills, but it is not true. We have a register of asthma deaths since 2014. And from these registers of the National Review of the Royal College of Physicians in the UK, we can see the pattern or the profile of these patients that are not always the severe patients. 58% were mild and moderate patients dying from asthma that year. They didn't have an asthma action plan, and that is significant. And that is why they were not assessed by a clinician in the last year. So these patients don't seek for attention. And they don't have maintenance prescription. They don't follow a regular ICS treatment. And that is why they are coping using a lot of salbutamol canisters. And this is, in my point of view, the concerning problem. Next slide, please. So as Emma said before, and she has explained it very well, the Sabina is the newest study we have from asthma. And I'm not going to go deeper in it, but in only one point, it caught my attention, is that the SABA relates the number of canisters with the risk of death or adverse outcomes. And that, in my point of view, is really concerning. And it should be a warning sign for all of us that are working with these patients, all the professionists who are in contact with these patients, that as this study says, we are not aware of that. One of the little results of this study says that there is a kind of pattern following the time. This study follows the patients 8 years. And what is curious is that the patient that is over-relying in SABA, for example, using 5 canisters a year, next year he's still using 5 canisters, and the other year he's still using a lot of SABA reliever therapy. So that makes me think that it's not only the patients who don't recognize the severity of the situation, but also the professionists that are not aware that this prescribed or not prescribed SABA tell us that there is an adverse a sign of warning. And I was thinking if this can happen in another chronic condition, for example, diabetes, we work with this kind of patients. Just try to imagine if one of these patients, a diabetic patient, had a result of a glycate hemoglobin of 9 or 10, which is very high, how much time would this patient be coping around without any of the professionists taking care of it? So this is the point of my speech today, that if we find this, we have to do something. And please next, Anikan. We have to change the follow-up of these patients. We don't have to keep this patient going around with these high levels of SABA using. Next slide, please. So what do we do? These patients are like fishes in the sea going around with this SABA over-reliance. And they come to my emergency room. They come to your pharmacy, they come to your hospital emergency department, they come to the pharmacist department, and who is in charge with these patients that are taking this SABA? We have to do something, and that is why the Asthma Right Care movement is for, and I am very happy to join it, because they have developed the tools. In the next slide, you will see. A very nice tool that I use a lot in my practice is the slide rule. I have it here. It is a very interactive and intuitive rule to show the patient the danger, the situation of danger where he is, depending on the number of SABA canisters he's using. We have in Spain now a social movement amongst the community pharmacists that are not selling SABA anymore over the counter. Previously, it was allowed in emergency situation with non-prescription in some situation. And that was the open window that the patient used to have the reliever medications and not going to the doctor to have a prescription. So since this situation happens, and this is a very good initiative of my colleagues, the community pharmacists in Spain, in the emergency room, we have now this kind of arising concern that all these patients at night and in the weekends or the feast days, they come to me, to my emergency room, to have a prescription. Not to seek for attention, but only for the prescription. And this is the point of starting the conversation about the SABA overuse and using these tools. Next slide, please. So emergency room that has previously seen that only putting patches in the diseases of our patients can be also seen as a first point of the starting point of the education of the patient, so we can be like fishermen catching this patient and doing something in these few minutes if we have time. Of course, if we don't have time, we won't do that. But if we have the little opportunity to take the patient and check about their condition, we can do many things in a few minutes, like checking if the diagnosis is right, if they are using their maintenance treatment, and the, how they use the rescue treatment. We can check inhaler technique and assess adherence. Of course, we will treat the actual crisis, and we will try not to be a recurrent patient because it is a risk factor of further crisis. We can also check smoking status and vaccinating status. There is a document that Toby will go on deeper later of the sample, samples document. But the goal in my setting and in very stretch contact with the community pharmacist is to put these patients, next slide, in the bucket of the right care. So our main goal is to refer these patients to their GP and follow visits for assessment of their disease. We have other tools, next slide please, issued from the Asthma Right Care, from the IPCRG for the emergency room, with top tips to assess patients with asthma or suspected asthma in the emergency room. It is a little document to be wearing in your pocket and to have more information in that moment. Oh, this is my speech. And finally, I want to show you graphically in a video my real experience with these patients, which I have in my emergency room, and which is real. This is a real life situation. Go ahead, Anika. Thank you very much. Well, of course, it was not a real patient, but this is a real situation and the feedback is always good. So I encourage you to get in touch with your emergency department and start doing the right care for our patients. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Marina. Toby, I've already introduced you, so the floor is yours to speak about delivering asthma right care for hospital pharmacists.
Wonderful. Yes, thank you for inviting me to speak here today. I just wanted to talk about some of the things that we can do as hospital pharmacists and how we identify where our priorities are within the right care movement. So next slide. So, one of the difficulties we have as pharmacists is asthma is often seen as really difficult and complicated, and people get a bit scared by it. Now, Professor Anna Murphy in Leicester developed a sort of like a mnemonic, simples, as a sort of like a way to guide people to manage asthma. So if you can just spin on through the animation here. So what we've got is a mnemonic simples, so there's one more on there. So we've got different ways of thinking about different components of an asthma review to just tick all those boxes to optimize people's asthma control. So we've got S for stop smoking, I for inhaler technique, M for monitoring, P for pharmacotherapy, L for lifestyle, so things like diet, nutrition, exercise, E for education about asthma and the drug treatment, and S for support and signposting patients to different resources, so local asthma charities or patient information literature that can help patients self-manage. And I'll go through some of these in a bit of detail during this presentation. So we can go to the next slide. And I think one thing we need to always remember before we get too focus on the medication is that actually the one of the most important interventions for our patients, whether they've got asthma or COPD or anything else, is if they're a smoker, we need to encourage them and help them to stop smoking. And we know from this data and in this study that if you're a current smoker, you're more than four times at risk of having poor asthma control. And even if you're an ex-smoker, you're still at a higher risk of having poor asthma control than somebody who's never smoked. And in England, there's a tagline for giving very brief advice is that it just takes 30 seconds to save a life. So just thinking about tagging on a question about smoking as a 30-second intervention in every patient contact that you have. First thing you do is three components. You ask, advise, and act. So ask people, do you smoke? And ask, are they a current smoker, an ex-smoker, if they never smoked? And if they are a current smoker, the next stage is going on to advise them that the most effective way to stop smoking is a combination of medication and support to give up, to help with that quit attempt. And then if patients are then think, actually, yes, I would be interested to learn about this, is then act on it. So think about within your area, your practice, what different pharmacotherapy options do you have? Do you have a combination of nicotine replacement therapy? Do you have any medications like varenicline, Champix? And what access do you have for local stop smoking services to give people that behavioral support to help get them through the quit attempt? And this really is one of the most important interventions and something we should be doing more and more and remembering to do it. So next slide. Just an animation as well, please. Inhaler technique is really, really important. And we know that if people have got poor inhaler technique, we know that it's associated with worse outcomes in both asthma and COPD. And on the left-hand side, we see a study in primary care in France. And what they looked at is they counted how many mistakes people use when they use salbutamol or an MDI inhaler. And then they looked at their asthma control. And as you move from left to right, the more errors you make, if you look at the shaded bars, the asthma control gets worse. So it's really good at showing that the worse your inhaler technique, your worse asthma control. And on the right-hand chart, we see in COPD, similarly, poor inhaler technique is associated with more frequent exacerbations. So next slide, please. And one thing I think we often miss is there's more data coming out now that the way people prescribe inhalers is really important as well. And I often see patients in my practice who prescribe, let's say, a dry powder maintenance inhaler that they take once or twice a day, every day, the steroid inhaler. But then they'll often get a salbutamol reliever in an MDI. And that's two different types of inhaler device. You've got a dry powder inhaler that you need to breathe in quick and deep, and you've got a reliever that you need to inhale slowly and steadily. And in both asthma and COPD, we've got data now that's showing that if you've got mixed inhaler devices, you have worse outcomes, you have worse control of your asthma, more exacerbations than if you use all dry powder inhalers or all aerosol inhalers. So that makes sense. If you've got somebody using a dry powder inhaler as a regular maintenance daily inhaler, they should use a dry powder reliever as well. Next slide, please. So we've developed this algorithm in the UK, and I know it's been translated into Polish. I believe it's been translated into Chinese as different dialects as well. And we want people to act on inhaler technique. So as a component of deciding which is the right inhaler for our patients to use, we should assess their ability to inhale through a device. So first, you can ask your patient, can you take a slow, steady breath over 3 to 5 seconds? Can you do this? That's how fast or how long you should be breathing in to use an MDI, an aerosol inhaler. Then you can ask the patient, can you take a quick deep breath within 2 to 3 seconds? Can you do this? If you can do that maneuver, you can use a dry powder inhaler. So that's then choosing, are you going to use a dry powder or an aerosol device? And you could think in that green box, think about the environment. In England now, we're thinking about aerosols, MDIs. They contain hydrofluoroalkanes, which are greenhouse gases. So we're trying to reduce the amount of that. And then once you've chosen the appropriate device within your local area, teach them how to use it and check they can use it correctly and check they're happy to use it. Next slide, please. And once we've taught patients how to use it, we should be giving them the ability to recheck their inhaler technique. And we should be doing that as pharmacists regularly anyway. But in the UK, we developed some inhaler technique videos that are available on the Asthma UK website. So I was involved in these. And we've designed a series of 3-minute videos, standardized evidence-based videos that help improve inhaler technique for the most commonly used devices in the UK. On the right-hand side, Right Breathe is another website. It's an app as well. And that has a series of inhaler technique videos for patients to re-familiarize themselves. And it's not just for patients, it's for us as healthcare professionals. If we can't use inhalers correctly, we can't teach our patients. So these are a good resource to help you learn how to use inhalers correctly. Next slide. Yeah, brilliant. So moving on to monitoring of asthma. And there is something called the Royal College of Physicians 3 questions. This is a really quick, simple way of having a discussion with your patients and getting an idea of how well they're controlled. So you can ask patients, have you had any nighttime symptoms, any difficulty in sleeping because of your asthma? Any daytime symptoms, cough, wheeze, chest tightness, breathlessness? And has your asthma interfered with any of your usual activities, whether it's doing your day job, going to school? And if you haven't had any problems here, you've got good control of asthma. If they're having anything here, there's a flag that actually the asthma is not particularly well controlled. So then we want to get a bit more in-depth detail about what's going on. And then we might move on to a questionnaire such as the asthma control test, which is on the next slide. And this is a 5-question questionnaire, and the patient can complete this. And it's a bit smaller on this screen, so if you just click on the next button, it'll just enlarge. And what we can see is there's 5 questions. So in the past 4 weeks, how often did your asthma prevent you from getting as much done at work, school, or home? Question 2, how often are you short of breath? Question 3, how often did you have nighttime symptoms? Question 4, how often are you using your reliever inhaler? And question 5 is, how would you rate your asthma control? So you'll get a total score from 5 to 25. So 25 is perfect asthma control, 20 to 24, that's good control. Anything less than that is worse asthma control. And I found this is really interesting because, as Marina was saying earlier, patients don't realize how badly their asthma is controlled. And I've seen people who've come with an ACT score here of 13, but thought their asthma was really well controlled. But using this, they actually see that actually maybe that my asthma is not as good as I thought it was. So it's really good at focusing people's thoughts. And this test is available in a variety of different languages as well. So moving on. So we've seen about optimizing pharmacotherapy. We've got the GINA guidance, and you will have local guidelines within your country as an area of practice as well. So I won't go into too much detail here. So we'll move on to the next slide. And again, we've seen the asthma slide rule. So I've got my own asthma slide rule, and I find this is a nice, useful way. Again, as Marina was saying, it's helping people think about actually how much salbutamol they use. So you can see it's a bit small on the screen, but you can ask people about their SABA usage and in a way that's meaningful for them. So is it how many SABA inhalers they're using each year? Is it how many puffs they're using each day or each week? And then you can just slide along here to think about how well they're controlled. And the good thing is that color scheme is there. So if it's green, it's a good indicator that they're doing okay. But as it's getting darker and more red, it can help people think, actually, maybe my asthma isn't as controlled as it was. And that allows you then to have that further discussions about their asthma control. And on the back of it, we have some other questions as well. So just moving on to the next slide. And we can see it just in a bit larger. It's helping people reflect on their SABA usage and thinking about, as a healthcare professional, as a pharmacist, if we see somebody who's using a lot of SABA, you can think about then, is how important does that high usage help you think that you need to review that patient's asthma control? So how high would you rank it on a scale of 0 to 10? And if it's not 10 and they're using a lot of salbutamol, what would it have been about that patient would have made you more likely to have that conversation? And you can ask a similar question for patients as well. So it's a good little tool as a conversation prompt. So next slide, please. Another tool that can be useful to help guide those consultations, help you understand how to have those conversations with patients, is there's a series of question and challenge cards that have been developed by Asthma Right Care. And the ways of thinking about these conversations and using different ways to prompt those conversations, whether it's metaphors, similes, mythbusters, or comments or challenges for patients. So just as some examples in the bigger text on the next slide. And again, these are available in a variety of different languages. So you can see on the left-hand side, there's a statement to challenge you as a healthcare professional, thinking about only 40% of people take their asthma treatment as it's prescribed, and only 30% of using them correctly, so they've got good inhaler technique. So overall, that means about 12% of people are using the right treatment correctly. And if you think about your patient population and only think 12% of those patients I see with asthma are using their treatment correctly, does that mean I'm going to change how I manage asthma? And just another example on the right-hand side is a metaphor. It's just to challenge people's way of thinking about it and thinking about your blue asthma reliever is like damping down a fire. If you have a fire, the best way to control it is to put out the embers, and to stop it flaring up, it's like using your inhaled corticosteroid. That puts out the fire. The salbutamol doesn't put out the fire, it isn't treating the cause. So moving on, next slide, please. Another tool that Asthma Right Care have developed is a reliever reliance test. In a similar setup as the asthma control test, it's using Rob Horn's belief about medicines questionnaires and getting people to think about the way that they're using their SABA inhaler. So thinking about asking patients about their concerns and their beliefs about using salbutamol. So thinking about, is it my blue reliever inhaler, it's the best way to keep on top of my asthma. In fact, move on to the next slide. We've got it's in bigger text here. So here you can see it better. So yes, question one, my blue reliever inhaler, it's the best way to treat, I use that to treat symptoms, and that's the best way to keep on top of my asthma. Do I strongly disagree? Do I strongly agree? Question two, I don't worry about my asthma because I've got my blue reliever inhaler. Question three, my blue reliever inhaler is the only asthma treatment I can really rely on. Question four, the benefits of my blue reliever inhaler easily outweigh any risks. And question five, I prefer to rely on my blue reliever inhaler more than my steroid preventer. So you can see these are looking at people's beliefs about the role of the salbutamol inhaler and how much they rely on it. And if you're getting a score of 18 to 25, it's indicating your patient has a very high risk of relying just on the salbutamol and not on their steroid inhaler. And it might prompt you to have that conversation about how they use their medicines. And part two of the question at the bottom of that slide, you can see it's a, how much they're using their salbutamol inhaler, not at all, up to more than five times a week. And if you're scoring at three, using it three times a week or more, that indicates that people are actually overusing it. So it's two parts to this questionnaire. Part one is their beliefs, their concerns, and part two is their actual use. And that prompts conversations, the conversation starter. So moving on to the next slide, please. So I want to just go into a few things that how we can lead asthma control in hospitals and how to improve things for our patients. So next slide. Now, in England, we have a national asthma and COPD audit. And within asthma, as part of the audit, the national audit, they've defined six elements of good practice on discharge for our patients who come in with an exacerbation of asthma. So they should say that everybody should have their inhaler technique checked. We should be reviewing their maintenance asthma treatment. We should have a discussion about adherence, give them a personalized action plan, talk about stopping smoking, and arrange follow-up. So if you just click on, and we can just see how often these interventions have made. And you can see actually in the latest audit, inhaler technique was only checked in 2/3 of our patients. Adherence, we didn't report that. Asthma action plans, less than 50% of patients are getting an asthma action plan. Only 40% of people are getting follow-up after discharge. And if you just click on once more, all six elements were only reported in about 1/3 of patients. So we have a lot more to do to improve our care during an asthma attack, during an admission for asthma. So next slide. So a few things that we can think about as a pharmacist, and this is Sammy Sweezer published this about 20 years ago now, and looking at the number of steroid inhalers that patients were using and look at their risk of asthma death. And they found that the risk of death was decreased by 50% for every extra steroid inhaler used within 6 months. And it's reduced, risk of death was reduced by 20% for every extra inhaler of steroid that was used over a 12-month period. So this is really good in thinking, actually, the more inhalers we can encourage our patients to use, the greater the risk, reduction in risk of death that they will have. And I think this is really important. We've got to focus our mind that improving steroid use will reduce the risk of our patients dying from asthma. Next slide, please. And we don't forget about salbutamol use. And this is just some more data that we have in England. And this is looking at the ratio of SABAs prescribed compared to steroid inhalers. And we find that actually for every one SABA inhaler prescribed, we see two steroid inhalers prescribed. So really, it's a really high use of SABA compared to steroid. And we've got primary care NHS data in England showing that roughly 20% of people with asthma are using at least six SABA inhalers each year. And we know from Sabina, if you're using at least three SABA inhalers, you are at higher risk of poor asthma outcomes. So we really have got a lot more to do, and it just focuses, we need to do more for our asthma population. Next slide, please. So how can we improve our adherence? Improving adherence is a long topic, and we could go into that for hours. But from my perspective, I think the things we need to be thinking about is exploring those reasons, thinking about people's beliefs and concerns, and that reliever reliance test is really good to tease out people's beliefs about using their SABA. And think about, do they have concerns about using their steroid inhaler? Do they believe that the salbutamol is better than the steroid? And trying to address some of those misconceptions. Thinking about unintentional reasons for poor adherence. So is it they can't afford their treatment? Is it they've got poor technique? Do they forget to take their inhalers? And can we prompt people about thinking about using their salbutamol? What do they do regularly every day that can prompt people to use their steroid inhaler? So for me, first thing I do in the morning when I get up is I have a cup of tea. If I have my steroid inhaler near my my kettle, it'll prompt me to use my steroid inhaler. But it's important we involve patients within this in this discussion, because we need to work out what's important for them. How will they benefit? What interventions can we make that will make that specific person in front of you improve their medicine's use? And solutions, really, primary thing is education. Talking to people about what asthma is, helping them understand that it's an inflammatory process that's going on in the lungs, and the treatment is a steroid inhaler. Inhaler technique, really, really good. And think about what's good for the patients. So moving on to the next slide, please. So inhaler technique, really, really important. This algorithm, really good to get people on the inhaler technique. Really important slide, this, which is why I put it up twice. So we'll move on to the next slide. And if we're choosing inhaler devices, I have a few top tips that I like to encourage that we think about. Because too often, we think about using the cheapest inhaler that's going to save us the greatest amount of money. But actually, the thing that's the most important is the priority is to achieve good control of asthma. If you go with using the cheapest inhaler that you've got, and it might be the only choice you've got, and that's fine, but if you've got a choice, it might not be the best thing for the patient. Get people an inhaler that they can use, are happy to use, because then that's going to optimize their asthma control. If they can't use their inhaler, you're going to have more exacerbations, more asthma attacks. You're going to go into hospital more. They can have more exacerbations, and that's going to be more costly. If you're interested about the environment, do think about actually using a lower carbon impact inhaler, like a dry powder device. But actually, the greenest inhaler is an inhaler device a patient can use and that they're happy to use. And if you have the option, think about it. Do you have recycling schemes for used inhalers, or how can you dispose of them safely so they don't just go into landfill? Because plastics in landfill will leach out and they can cause toxicity into the as it leaches out into water courses. And we only prescribe inhalers after we've taught patients how to use them, they've checked they can use them. So moving on to the next slide, please. And I just want to talk about something that we've done recently in my local hospital, and that we're thinking, if we don't teach patients how to use their inhalers, they're going to keep coming back into hospital. So we had a project and we set up a dedicated inhaler technique service using some of our pharmacy support workers. So they're not pharmacists, they're not pharmacy technicians, but they work within the pharmacy team. We taught them how to teach patients how to use their inhalers, and that was their dedicated role. So click on one. And what we see is on the chart that hopefully will come up on the left-hand side, look at those two columns on the left. And we can see before, when patients came in, we looked in inhaler technique and we assessed them in green as being optimal, perfect technique. Amber being it's satisfactory, it's okay. There's some minor issues, but it's okay. And red, this is unsatisfactory. They're not going to get any of the dose. And we saw that only about a quarter of patients had perfect technique. Our pharmacy support workers taught them how to use their inhalers correctly, and we got 91% perfect. Everybody else was okay, and it was satisfactory. The other two columns we've got in the middle, aerosols, devices, and on the right-hand side, we've got dry powders. We had similar improvements in inhaler technique. And then what we did is we followed them up. And if we click on once more, what we saw is that over a 6-month period before and after this intervention, we've reduced the mean number of exacerbations by about a third, and the mean number of repeat exacerbations with their asthma by almost 50%, just by teaching patients how to use their inhalers correctly. I think this is a really, really important intervention, and we need to do more. And patients loved it. I want to think about some of the challenges that we all face. And just a couple of things is, we have patients ringing up their GPs regularly and said, I've used my steroid rescue pack. Can I have a new one? And a new prescription gets printed out for some more steroids to use if their asthma gets bad. And we can see in data across England that we've got people using lots and lots and lots of courses of prednisolone, and they're not being challenged. Are they using them appropriately? And not only that, people who are using them, are they getting reviewed to say, actually, your asthma doesn't seem to be well controlled at the moment. What can we do to optimize that? Another thing we have is we get a lot of the time, if you click on once more, is patients ring up and say, I've got a nebulizer machine. Can you prescribe me some salbutamol nebules for it? And yes, they've got a nebulizer machine because they've bought it on Amazon, or they bought it from their on a car boot sale, or they found it on the local market, or often it's my next door neighbor died and they had a nebulizer, so they gave it to me. And then the GP goes, oh, they've got a nebulizer machine, we'll give them some salbutamol nebules for it. And it perpetuates this extra lots of SABA usage with a nebulizer, which is really, we need to be addressing more. Next slide, please. And then other thing is about asthma exacerbations. We need to be helping our patients self-manage and helping them understand actually what is good asthma control. And sometimes people think asthma control is, I'm using my SABA inhaler three or four times a day, and it means I can do what I want to do, and I think that's good control, but it isn't. And good asthma action plans will help people think about their asthma control being in this green zone. So I'm not getting symptoms, so I'm using my regular steroid preventer every day. And then they're moving on to the amber zone when things are starting to get worse, and in the red zone when I'm having a clear asthma attack. So these are really good. And before we go on to this slide, I just want to introduce a poll. So hopefully we're going to get a poll to just pop up here, just for a bit of audience participation. So if you've got somebody who's come into hospital with an asthma attack, how often do you connect with your local community practitioners, whether it's your GP or your community pharmacy team, to follow up patients after they've had an asthma attack? So do you do it for nearly every patient of yours? Do you do it just when you have time? Do you do it occasionally, or do you never do it? So hopefully you should be able to vote now. It's telling me that we cannot vote. Can we make this accessible for people to vote? I don't seem to be able to vote.
People are voting at the moment, Toby.
Yeah, brilliant. Thank you. So we'll just give that a few more seconds for people to vote. And then do we have any results? Oh, fabulous. So what we're seeing then is the most commonly reported thing is that about a third of people who've been able to respond never liaise with their community team, so community pharmacy, their GP. And then about a quarter occasionally do it, quarter do it when they have time. And then we have a few who are really good and do it nearly every patient. That's fabulous. And I think this is probably an issue in every country and probably every hospital is actually, how do we do it? And difficulty we have in England is knowing which community pharmacy people are going to use, because you don't register necessarily with a community pharmacy, but some people might have a regular pharmacy that they use. So if we just click on one system that we've started to develop in England is community pharmacists are commissioned nationally to provide what's called a discharge medication service. So community pharmacists are paid to do medicines use reviews in patients who've been discharged from hospital to help support them as they transfer back into the community to use their inhalers. And we've set up locally an electronic referral scheme. And if we just click on to see our electronic referral form, and this is where we have attached to the patient's hospital medical record, it's an electronic form, and we can click on the left-hand side, we can find their community pharmacy, and then we can just link it to their community pharmacist. On the right-hand side, we can then, we've got a series of tick boxes of what we want our pharmacist to do, whether it's providing a compliance aid or if there's any specific medication issues. So I've ticked here, this is a patient where they've had a new medicine started, they've got problems with their adherence, and then the additional information free text box, I've just typed in saying, we've commenced a new inhaler, I've taught them how to use it, but please could you support them in using this device and recheck their inhaler technique in a few weeks' time just to check their understanding, check they've got the message correctly. And at the point of discharge, this electronic form automatically gets emailed to that community pharmacy. So once I've set up this form and I've saved it on the patient's record, it automatically emails when they go home. And that hopefully will give our patients a better service. I really like that. So that's my last slide. So thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Toby. And actually, this was a very nice finish to your presentation that links really well with the last with this segment, this following segment of the presentation of this session, which is a conversation between hospital pharmacists and community pharmacists. Apart from Toby, who will also participate in the conversation, it is my pleasure to now introduce another participant, representative from the hospital pharmacy section, Dr. Elizabeth Autry. She's a graduate of the University of North Carolina Eshelman School of Pharmacy in Chapel Hill, North Carolina. She completed her PGY1 residency at Vidon Medical Center and then her PGY2 in pediatrics at UK Healthcare. After finishing her specialty training, Dr. Autry is currently a pediatric clinical pharmacist with an emphasis in pulmonary, allergy, and immunology. Dr. Autry holds an adjunct appointment at the University of Kentucky College of Pharmacy and is currently the assistant residency program director for the PGY2 in pediatric pharmacy. She also serves as a mentor to the PGY1 pharmacy practice residents, PGY2 pediatric residents, and preceptor to PGY1 and 2 residents and APPE students. She served as chair of the Preceptor Development Committee at UK Healthcare from May 2017 to June 2019. So welcome, Elizabeth.
Yes, thank you for that introduction. Definitely excited to be here today share my experiences.
Yes, exactly. And that was what I was going to propose based on the presentations that you've already seen in your practice. What can you tell us about the importance of relationships, interactions, and if you have any experience and or any reflection on what has been presented here today?
Certainly. I think Toby really hit on some great points with his experience from the hospital side of things as well. I think one of the biggest things, I have actually a hybrid role. I am inpatient with pediatric pulmonary service, but I also have a clinic-based practice where I'm seeing these asthma patients, other pulmonary patients after hospital discharge to kind of reinforce some of these items. But some of the initiatives that we have on the inpatient side is we partner with pharmacy as well as our respiratory therapist to really enforce inhaler technique. We check some boxes before hospital discharge to make sure the patients have what they need. We review technique. We escalate therapy as needed. We really touch on what is their short-acting bronchodilator use? Do we need to optimize and transition to like the single inhaler corticosteroid plus long-acting like formoterol product? That's definitely been a huge practice change in the United States. The GINA guidelines have certainly been at the forefront with recommending that low-dose inhaled corticosteroid and formoterol product, but we're really seeing that shift in the United States. And so in using that as an opportunity, focused education in the hospital side to transition what inhaler they may be doing, but reinforcing that on the outpatient setting with community pharmacy. Toby kind of touched on, there's the dry powder inhalers, there's the metered dose inhalers. So there's a variety of options that do exist. And I think it's important to partner with that community pharmacist to reinforce those inhaler techniques. I know oftentimes I work with the community pharmacist for these patients to get a refill history. How often are they filling their short-acting bronchodilator? How often are they refilling their controller therapy? How many courses of steroids have they had for an acute exacerbation? So we can then optimize and tailor on the inpatient side to then set them up for success, hopefully in the outpatient setting.
Well, thank you very much. And that's very interesting that, and as you've also mentioned, the conversation with the patient is so important. How do we do, how do you ensure that there is alignment between what are the messages that are conveyed by your service and then what other healthcare professionals that possibly also care for that patient also say, is there any type of relationship? Have you managed to open communication channels? We have seen that still a high percentage of participants have said that they never contact other healthcare professionals upon discharge. Is that also are there also difficulties in your practice?
Yes, certainly. Just knowing where I'm at in the United States, in Lexington, Kentucky, we actually have a pretty big referral center that we see like half of the state comes to our center. So I do think it becomes some limitations in trying to make sure we have all those touch points with outside providers of things we may have optimized on the inpatient setting. I know at time of discharge, we're very fortunate at our institution, at our hospital, we do have some community pharmacies that are affiliated that at time of discharge, if we are starting new therapies, we do make sure the patient has what they need in hand. We make sure there's no barriers to them getting that particular medication therapy. I know with the transition to the low-dose inhaled corticosteroid for formoterol products, that's been a huge practice change to where we have to do extra steps, maybe with the patient's insurance to be able to get that inhaler in hand. Refocusing the education of you're not using your albuterol product or salmeterol product as your rescue and reinforcing that with their primary care provider as an outpatient, but as well as making sure the necessary prescriptions are sent to their preferred community pharmacy and reinforcing that, again, techniques been reviewed, counseling points on when to use this and why we're using this, and then partnering with them to reinforce that. So certainly with the breadth of patients and the areas that they're coming from, there's certainly those rate limiting steps, but we try to ensure discharge paperwork sent to the appropriate parties to know of interventions that have been had. And if it is really that high risk patient with multiple admissions, multiple courses of steroids, probably more tailored approach to ensure a partnership is more fruitful with all care team members.
Thank you, Elizabeth. I don't know, Toby, if you'd like to get involved in the conversation. We have we did see some differences in terms of the poll that you sent, in that it had a lot of distribution between those that frequently talk to each other and those that never do. What do you think that could be done better, or what kind of political triggers can we push in order to ensure that there is more communication? Because I think that we all agree that more communication is better, but we have to use our time efficiently as well. So that might also be an issue. So.
Yeah, I think it's quite complicated because there's so many different community pharmacies. The biggest difficulty I have is trying to work out which pharmacy a patient goes to. So you'll ask the patient, which pharmacy do you get your medicines from? And they'll tell you, but it will be a chain pharmacy that has about 10 different branches in the city. So you then spend a long time trying to work out which it is. And that is a challenge that I suspect occurs everywhere. But it does make a big difference, actually, if you can get that support to get that extra care from the pharmacy long term. And I mean, we set up an inhaler technique service for community pharmacists where they're commissioned to teach patients how to use their inhalers. And there's a lot of engagement. Pharmacists wanted to do this, so they really want to be involved. So it's worth taking those steps to actually get those links. And if there's a way you can get clear lines of referral, and it's been developing more and more in England over the last few years, and that actually we have systems to do it in a lot of areas now. It's by no means it's everywhere, but it's getting there. And it's a system wide and communicating between the trust and also the community pharmacy network. It's a big challenge.
Well, and we can't say that the problem is the technology itself, because technology, I think that nowadays it responds to whatever we design, but it's really about how do we design it in a way that is effective and takes into account also the pressure and the workload that all healthcare professionals have, of course, and how also in terms of data protection, obviously that has to be taken into account as well. So there's a lot of different issues, ethical, political, not only in terms of technology development that have to be taken into account and be aligned. But I agree with you, Toby. I think we're getting there. So, and I think that there are more and more experiences coming up of good partnering relationships and better channels for communication.
Yeah.
So as we are moving to towards the almost the end of the session, I don't know, Elizabeth, you've come in a little bit later. So I don't know if you would like to add something to our conversation before we move to the Q&A session.
I think this has been great. It's exciting for me to hear of the initiatives that are being done elsewhere that I can kind of take back to my practice to adapt and adopt for our patient care. I know with the variety of inhalers, we certainly rely on pharmacy, respiratory therapist, and other individuals to ensure that technique and reinforcing that with every visit, every hospital admission, every outpatient prescription, and really following with that, because we do have such a variety. We have our inhaler varieties posted all in clinic and on the hospital side, so patients be able to identify which one they're using, whether it's a soft mist inhaler, a dry powder. And there's just such a variety. And Toby, you hit it spot on. Like, if we can just identify a single type of device that we can reinforce that technique, that is certainly optimal. And I try to do that on a routine basis, but sometimes we have some limitations when it comes to payers.
Well, thank you, Elizabeth, very much again for your participation. And also Toby, and we will now move to the next part, which is first a call to action. So I'm sure that all of you are very curious to know how you can join this social movement to improve asthma care to patients worldwide. So if you do want to help us deliver better asthma care, then you can find out more at www.ipcrg.org/asthmarightcare. So there are a lot of resources, tools, and more information on how you can become involved. And if you get really excited about joining us, then you have this email, businessmanager@ipcrg.org, which you can use to contact us and get involved. We already had a few contacts following the the webinar we did for community pharmacy 2 weeks ago. So hopefully we will also have motivated some of you to also participate. In this website, you can see also a lot of the tools that Toby and Marina have showed us during their presentations. So we do have one question. Well, actually two. One of them, Marina has already kindly responded by in written, but maybe we can open it up so that other participants can also hear. So Marina, if I can invite you again to the conversation. There was one question on the use of the various theophylline products. We still see it being used. And if there is a place, where would it be?
Well, yes, they are still being used as, well, this machine of treatments are not changing, are not updated, but theophylline products are not in the guidelines anymore. It is not a treatment no longer, even if it was, and if it helped a lot in the past, and it they were really used also in our settings. But in the last evidence shows that the risk benefit is not for the risk benefit balance is not for the use of theophyllines. Given that the current treatments are effective if they are used in the right way in the emergency care departments. So the guidelines also make the difference between the primary care departments. So where we do the first treatment, the first approach to the patient with repeated courses of SABA and oxygen support, and if it needed, systemic corticoids, of course. And the important thing in the asthma crisis is the assessment, so the continuous assessment of the patient with all the variables, and when the patient is not improving in the function or their status. So the important thing in the primary care is to transfer the patient into the hospital setting, where they have a more challenge to more as a setting to assess these patients, and they may use other options that come by the magnesium and other treatments, antibiotic if it is necessary, but not anymore theophyllines in settings where we have the choice. This is the point.
Yeah, and I would certainly echo theophylline or associated products have fallen out of favor at our institution when it comes to managing asthma exacerbations. We have removed it from our protocol, given those reasons from a toxicity standpoint near therapeutic index.
I think just to add to that as well, there was a recent paper published, and I was just trying to find, I can't remember where it was, but it was looking at low-income countries about trying to use theophylline for maintenance therapy and seeing if it was had any benefit. I think it was in comparison to inhaled corticosteroids, and it just wasn't particularly effective as well. So I think for maintenance therapy, it's not a great treatment. It's not particularly effective, and you can still buy theophylline over the counter in England, which is incredible when you have to do blood monitoring to make sure you've got a safe and effective serum level. And you just can't really do that very easily if you're just buying it. So, I don't think it has a major role.
And what about SABA for COPD? This is another question we have from one of the participants. What if the diagnosis isn't right and the person has COPD?
Again, there is some data as well for if you're using a lot of salbutamol in COPD, it's a sign that you've got poor control, and actually it's associated, it's a marker for worse outcomes. It's possibly not as big an issue with asthma, possibly, but I do think if you've got somebody who's using a lot of salbutamol in COPD, obviously we're not optimizing their maintenance therapy with long-acting bronchodilators. Thinking about inhaled corticosteroids if they have repeated exacerbations or high eosinophils. But yeah, if you're using a lot, we need to optimize other therapies.
Thank you. Well, and we have maybe one last question. What can FIP do to help countries in low and middle income countries offer choice to patients? I guess that this is about what can we do as a global community in order to improve care for patients. And I think that this webinar is a good example. So sharing best practices, and there are a lot of webinars being run by FIP. And we actually, if you go to the chat box, there is a link there if you would like to stay informed about new FIP digital events in different areas of practice, then you can sign up for our newsletter using that form. So, and you are welcome to join us, of course. FIP is now running a series of transformation events in terms of combating non-communicable diseases and also increasing the uptake of immunization by pharmacists around the world. So we have a transformation series on vaccination going on at the moment, and we will soon be launching a new programs on non-communicable diseases, particularly in terms of, and we will be launching one on diabetes very soon, but we are just starting this also initiative in terms of respiratory diseases. So hopefully you will join us, and we can in this way help you to improve your practice. And also, obviously, FIP as a federation of member organizations, we also engage with member organizations to ensure that they have the advocacy tools to liaise with governments in order to implement and acknowledge services provided both by hospital and community pharmacists. So these are a few of the ways that we hopefully can contribute to the advancement of health globally. So I think that we can wrap up, and I would like to thank Marina, Toby, and Elizabeth for their contributions. Obviously, we have seen again that asthma still is a big challenge that we have to address. As we've seen, this is good news, we have a lot of tools and a lot of people involved and stakeholders involved in this movement. And we have motivation, and we have you as well wanting to participate. So this is very good news for asthma patients around the world. We would like to acknowledge IPCRG's participation in collaboration with FIP in terms of the organization of these two events, and hopefully these will be the first two of many to come. Thank you very much again for your participation, and please join us in the campaign for World Pharmacists Day on the 25th of September. We have already started the celebrations, so hopefully we will see you there on the virtual space celebrating with us. And again, don't forget that we are organizing series of digital events. So please join us by clicking on the link that is provided on this slide if you would like to know more about our programming. Thank you very much again. Have a good week and see you soon. Thank you.